I am Laura Dixon, and you are listening to the Naturally Thin for Life podcast, episode number 63, Blessing and Curse of Willpower. Welcome to the Naturally Thin for Life podcast. I'm going to teach you how to get out of your diet brain so that you too can be naturally thin for life. No counting, restricting, or obsessing. I am going to take the mystery out of it for you so that you can become naturally thin starting today. Are you ready? Let's do this. Hello, friends. Welcome back to the podcast. Today, we are going to talk about willpower. I love the topic of willpower because I'm a former willpower junkie. I used to be so proud of myself for how much willpower I thought I had. And I did have a lot, but it also came with some consequences I didn't love. And I'm going to teach you today why, of course, you want some willpower, but also why you don't want to rely on it when you're losing weight for the last time. And before we get started, if you're loving the podcast and you're getting a lot out of it, if you can take a minute to write a review and leave a review, and don't forget to subscribe so you're getting all of the latest episodes, that helps other people find the podcast as well. And those people who don't even know that it exists yet. I just have to read this to you. Someone left a review yesterday, and I actually teared up reading the review. Because this journey to being naturally thin is so much more than the weight. It's about the freedom from the battle and from the obsession. So I'm going to read you what she wrote. This is from Bubba Mush. I love that. She says, "Thank you, Laura, for this gift. This is so amazing. I just listened to episode number 50, A Gift to My Daughter, and I bawled. I literally sobbed through most of it. I am so thankful for the work you've done on yourself, Laura, and that you've chosen to pass this gift of practical, applicable knowledge on to those of us who still struggle. You're so right. This is the most amazing gift you could give to anyone. I've struggled my entire life with food, my body, diets, and trusting myself with anything. I've been on quite a journey coming home to myself, and I'm thrilled you're now a part of my journey. I'm excited to work with you further and give this gift to myself first, and then hopefully to others as well. Thank you, thank you, thank you." And I think, and I just believe so strongly that when we can pass this gift of being free from the struggle and the obsession, when we can give that gift to ourselves and then pass it on to others through our example, think about the impact that will have on this world. I love imagining a world where we don't struggle with our weights and we're just in the bodies that we want to be in and we feel comfortable and we trust ourselves, not just around food, but in all areas of our life. So this podcast, I know, is a big part of that journey for so many of you. And so I say thank you so much in advance. And I know the other women and or men, I know you men are listening too, that haven't found the podcast yet, they also say thank you. So when you write a review and leave a review, it helps the podcast suggest this podcast to other people like you so that they too can finally start to be free from the struggle. Now, I want to go back to talking about willpower. So the definition, per the Google dictionaries, is that willpower is control exerted to do something or restrain impulses. That isn't really what it is when we think about what's required for willpower, but I think it's important to acknowledge that a lot of us grow up and learn that we need willpower to override something, quote unquote, bad inside of us. We think there's like this morality with willpower. What willpower really is, it's not necessarily control exerted to do something or restrain impulses. I think that implies there's a badness to it. Willpower simply is taking an action when you don't have a thought that aligns with the action. For example, when you have a thought in your brain, "I don't want to get out of bed," when that sentence is going through your mind, you then need willpower to get out of bed. Because you're taking an action, getting out of bed, that doesn't align with the thought, I don't want to get out of bed. So the action getting out of bed is coming up against the thought, I don't want to get out of bed. They don't agree. They don't match. That's when willpower is required, right? There's no morality associated with it when we think about simply getting out of bed, which is different than when you're having a thought, I want to get up right now, and you get up. There's no willpower needed there because your action of getting up is not trying to fight against the thought, I don't want to get out of bed, because instead you're thinking, I want to get up right now. So I want to start by saying, yes, of course there are times we want to have willpower, but it doesn't need to be the sole source of change. Because have you noticed? It doesn't work long term. If it did, we would all not be struggling with our weight, right? Like, I was so good at willpower, but with our weight, we can't use willpower forever. It actually fades. I used to tell myself, I'm really good at powering through things, powering through projects, tests, new tasks. And it was how I created a lot of success in my career. Even when I had an 18-month-long project that I volunteered to take on and lead, I would still tell myself I can power through this on a day-to-day basis. But here's the thing with willpower, especially when you think about a project at work or any project, really, anything we take on, you get a break. If you're at work, you get to come home. Or maybe now you're working at home, but you end your workday and maybe you take off weekends and you have vacation time and you also have other projects too, not just the one that you're focused on. But when you're really good at willpower and you find yourself using it a lot during the day, regardless of what you're using it for, and then you have a diet brain, which means the way that you think about food isn't aligned with just easily allowing hunger and easily satisfying your hunger, and you're trying to lose weight, you are usually out of willpower by the end of the day. If you've dieted, obsessed, and then food and losing weight is most likely on your mind a lot, you don't really get a break from it. So when you're trying to use willpower, you're not just trying to use willpower some of the time, you're trying to use willpower all of the time. And then the willpower fades. It's why you can be so good at willpower during the day and feel like you don't have any left in the evening. It's because you actually don't have any left in the evening. When you think about starting your day, needing willpower to get out of bed, needing willpower to put on clothes, needing willpower to maybe brush your teeth or do whatever you're trying to do in the morning, when your brain is battling all of the action you're doing, starting from when you get up, of course in the evening, you're going to be eating like 4 rounds of snacks. You just don't have any willpower left. You've used it all up. So I want to help you not only use less willpower for losing weight, but in your life in general, because then you have more energy. So willpower is both a blessing and a curse. Because if you're really good at willpower and you're like me thinking I can power through anything, then what you go to do to lose weight is you try to use more willpower. That's the curse of relying on your ability to use willpower. Right? But it's also a blessing in certain instances. There's some times that our brain doesn't want to do things and we're like, nope, we're just going to do it anyways. And we use willpower to do it. When I think about getting up in the middle of the night, like, yes, of course, for my kids. Yes, of course, I want to get up for them. Thankfully, they don't get up very much anymore. Right? But I'm not like, yay, I'm so excited to get up. There's a little bit of willpower that has me getting up to go help my daughter who is teething in the middle of the night. Right? So yes, I want willpower, but I don't want it to be the sole source of anything I'm trying to do in my life because it's so draining. And with your weight loss, you cannot use willpower to lose weight and keep it off for good and have it be effortless. Because the effortlessness means your brain's thoughts and feelings are in alignment with the action of not overeating. So to have it be effortless, it means you don't even want to eat in the first place. So that means there's no need for willpower. It's why you can lose weight and keep putting it back on, because you're relying on willpower. You haven't actually changed what's happening in your brain that wants you to overeat in the first place. To lose weight and keep it off, and have it be effortless, which is being naturally thin, you don't need willpower because you don't even want to overeat anymore. So just because you can use willpower and just because you have used willpower before to lose weight doesn't mean that's what you should be relying on to lose weight for the last time. When I go back to my getting out of bed example, think about how much less energy you need when you genuinely believe, I want to get out of bed, and you get out of bed, versus I don't want to get out of bed, and overriding that default thinking and trying to get yourself out of bed when you're thinking, I don't want to get out of bed. You literally start your day, like I said before, relying on willpower. So again, yes, there's times you want to use willpower. It's why we have it. It's why we were created to be able to use it. But you don't want it to be your default. So now I think of myself as a person who can power through things, but I just don't need to. I have a lot of willpower, but it's like always sitting in a reserve. I just don't really need to rely on it. There's so much freedom in knowing that, yes, it's there if I need it, but I just don't need it. I know that I spend more energy understanding my brain so that I don't need it in the first place, and it's so much easier that way. And sure, of course, it's there for the times I do want it. And this is what I want you to try on. You can show your brain that when it says, I don't want to do something, it's almost always a lie because you do want whatever the other side of that thing is. It's more like a loving discipline that I talk about in episode 57 than willpower. So when you think about getting out of bed, right? Maybe you do actually want to get out of bed because you don't want to be late, because you want to have the time in the morning, you don't want to be rushed. That's what I mean by it's kind of a little lie that your brain tells you, I don't want to get out of bed. You probably actually do want to get out of bed because you want whatever's on the other side of it. You want whatever's on the other side of not snoozing your alarm 5 times. If you are someone that is really good at willpower, then when you go to use that same willpower to lose weight, it is so much more challenging because it's a lifelong need for willpower. And if your willpower fades, so will your attempt at losing weight. This is why it's different than the project at work or the task you're focused on. Because losing weight and keeping it off is something you do for the rest of your life. You don't get a break from it. So when you don't need willpower, you don't need a break from it. There's nothing to break from because it's just easy for you to allow your hunger and satisfy your hunger, and you don't even want to overeat. Because when you don't even want to overeat, not because you're restricting and depriving yourself, but because you just don't enjoy the discomfort of overeating, you don't need willpower. You go through your day not battling yourself, not battling with your relationship with food, and you have so much more energy. The energy required to override a default thought, to override default thinking, like I don't want to get out of bed, is so much more draining than what I'm going to challenge you to do, which is to question that thought, I don't want to get out of bed in the first place. To question the thought, I really want to keep eating. To question the thought, I just can't turn that down. To question all of those thoughts, to challenge those thoughts, to show your brain that actually they aren't even true in the first place, because then you don't need the willpower. Because like I said before, you do want to get out of bed, right? You don't want to be rushing. You want to be on time. You want to spend a few minutes with your kids before you go to work. Maybe you want to move your body. Maybe you want that amazing, quiet, glorious time before your kids get up. So when you can actually see that you do want to get out of bed, it's why you set your alarm in the first place. It is a much better use of your brain's energy to question and challenge the I don't want to thought in the first place than it is to rely on willpower. Because when you question it and change it, then you stop needing willpower, not only for that day, but for all of the days going forward. The compound effect on the energy saving is tremendous. Here's the other difference with how you use willpower in other areas of your life. And so I'm going to stick with a career example here, but it doesn't matter. Pick any area of your life. We usually use willpower to take action, to get out of bed, to take on a new project, to have a difficult conversation with an employee, to make more money, to go after the promotion. So when we're using willpower in that way, you are overriding thought patterns that don't align with an action you want to take. So you're actually taking action in all of those situations. But with food and losing weight, when you're solely relying on willpower, you're using willpower to take inaction, to not eat, to eat less. So it's different. And then when you're trying to use willpower to not take action, to not eat, your brain, it's not quite totally sure what to do with itself when you're focused on willpower for inaction. When you think about willpower for action, it's really clear what you're going to be doing. Your brain can get on board a little bit easier when you think about doing this task, finishing this project, putting that slide deck together, getting out of bed, brushing your teeth, whatever it is, right? You're taking action. Your brain's like, okay, we're going to do this. But when you're using willpower to take in action, you're kind of left with this, like, I imagine you kind of sit there and you look around, your eyes are just looking around like, okay, but now what? It's why you try to substitute other activities, like going for a walk or reading a book or having tea, all of which are great, but the motivation behind them when they're a substitute is because you just haven't figured out how to be with yourself. When you're using willpower to get a slide deck done on time, you aren't just left hanging out with yourself. This is why it's so important to also redirect that excess desire you have for food to creation and relaxation activities that you love that are so much more enjoyable than food. And I talk you through that in the previous episode, in episode 62. So just because you have used willpower before to lose weight doesn't mean it's the long-term solution. And I know you know that. Because if it was, you wouldn't need any help. You would already be there. So here are some ways I want you to be on to your brain and shift from using willpower to not needing it nearly as much. Instead of spending that mental energy on willpower, I want you to spend it on questioning what creates the need for the willpower in the first place. How you're going to do that is when you notice that you have any version of a thought your brain is telling you that is something like, I have to, I need to, or I should, and any of the opposites as well. I don't have to, I don't need to, I shouldn't do this. You want to question whatever comes after the have to, need to, or should. Because here's the thing, we all have free will. You actually don't have to do anything, even paying your taxes. I love this example. You don't have to pay your taxes, but you might want to, because you don't want the consequence of a fine or potentially jail time for tax evasion, and you don't want to deal with the IRS. So even with something like paying your taxes, it might not mean you love paying them, but you want to pay them because you prefer that than the alternative. So your experience of paying taxes when you tell yourself, I don't want to pay taxes, or I have to pay taxes, versus actually, I do want to pay taxes. It's a different experience of paying your taxes. So if you're going to pay them either way, you might as well tell yourself the truth that you actually do want to pay them. That's why you're paying them. We never do anything we don't truly want to do. So when your brain is like, I don't want to pay my taxes. I don't like doing this. I have to do this. You can be honest with yourself that those are really just little lies your brain is offering up to you. You do actually want to pay your taxes because you don't want the alternative. Even the thought, I have to go to work. It's not true. You don't have to go to work. You could lie in bed all day and watch Netflix and eat all the cookies. But you want to go to work because you pride yourself on being someone that shows up and doesn't just bail on work. You want the challenges at work. You want the mental stimulation and you want the paycheck. You want all the things, right? So when you show your brain that, oh, actually, I do want to go to work today, right? Maybe I'm not all jazzed up every day to go to work. Maybe I am more on some days, but even days that your brain is like, I don't want to go to work, you can show yourself that even that is a lie. It is the same with food. When you are thinking the thoughts, I want to eat the second serving, even though I know I will feel heavy and bloated if I do, you want to question that. That thought has both, I want to eat, and I don't want to eat because I will feel heavy and bloated. The I want to eat part is just a little bit louder because you haven't really questioned it before. But when you truly ask yourself, do I want to feel heavy and bloated? and the answer is no, that allows you to stop eating so much more easily. Rather than telling yourself, I really want to keep eating, but I have to stop. The I have to stop can just as easily be, I want to stop because I want to feel good. That's how the end to the restriction and the deprivation happens, is because you just want to only eat when you're hungry. You just want to stop when you're satisfied. And when you get to actually tell yourself, oh, I don't want to keep eating. That's just a lie my brain is telling me, and I'm going to challenge it, and I don't have to believe it. You learn that your body and your brain's true desire is to not overeat. It is a false pleasure in the moment when we overeat. So instead of looking to willpower to not eat that second serving of food in this example, take that energy and question the thought that has you wanting to eat in the first place. When you show yourself over and over again that these little lies of I want to eat this, even though you know your future self, a day, a month, an hour, a year from now would be so thankful that you didn't eat it, even though you know that, the more you can show your brain that the I want to eat when I'm not hungry, I want to eat past the point of being satisfied, I want to eat this food that doesn't feel good in my body, when you can show yourself that that's just a lie, you actually don't really want to eat it because you want to feel comfortable, you don't want to feel bloated, you want to lose weight, you want to enjoy being in your body. When you can do that more and more, you will need willpower less and less. That truly is how the battle ends. Then, when you're at work looking at the cupcakes that Susie brought in for her birthday, I don't even know actually, are they letting people bring in food during COVID? Anyways, let's pretend though, someone brought in food, right? There's cupcakes sitting there. And when you've taught your brain in that moment that actually I don't want them right now because I'm not hungry. And I know when I eat a cupcake, I feel an energy drain of the sugar drop, and I know I'm going to have a slight headache, and I know I'm going to lose that light, airy feeling I have right now, and I know I'm going to be craving more sugar later. When you show your brain that actually I don't want it for all of these reasons, that becomes your brain's default thought pattern. You don't need to battle yourself to not eat the cupcake. It's easy to just not eat it. There's nothing that happens. You just see it and you don't want it. And that's it. That's how it truly becomes effortless. Your brain and body's true desire is to feel good. That's what your brain and body both genuinely want for you. So the more you question these thoughts that lead you to overeat, and the more you show yourself you actually don't want to overeat because you want to feel good, that true desire of wanting to feel good will become the predominant desire. And as a consequence, as an amazing consequence, as a result of that, the benefit of that true desire of wanting to feel good becoming the predominant desire, that means your over-desire for food will go away. Because that over-desire for food isn't congruent with the true desire of wanting to feel good in your body. You can do this without the willpower drain. I have a client who said she was out this past weekend and she had two drinks with friends, and she said, I didn't even realize this until after the fact, but I wasn't nibbling on all of the food around. I wasn't even eating. I didn't have to consciously worry about if I had a drink, whether or not I would find myself snacking. It's because she doesn't rely on willpower anymore. And drinking alcohol often makes it more difficult to rely on willpower. It's why we often overeat when we overindulge with alcohol, because we can't use as much willpower when we've had some drinks. So now, even when she drinks, it doesn't matter because willpower isn't what has her eating only when she's hungry and stopping when she's satisfied. That has become her innate default thinking. This can be you too. It doesn't matter how many years you've dieted, how long you've tried. All that matters is your willingness to challenge the thoughts that you have now in this moment, regardless of how long they've been there. It truly doesn't matter whether they've been around for 40 years or 4 minutes. You can still challenge them and change them. If you want more help with this, make sure to keep listening to how you can join us inside of the Naturally Thin for Life program. It is the community of women becoming naturally thin for the rest of their lives. I had someone join not even 2 weeks ago. She's already lost 5 pounds. And not the strict diet restriction deprivation. I think maybe it's just water weight 5 pounds. Genuinely lost 5 pounds and has kept losing weight and isn't worried about those 5 pounds coming back. So I hope to see you all in there. I cannot wait for you to experience the freedom that comes on the other side of being naturally thin for the rest of your life. I hope you all have an amazing day, my friends, and I will talk to you all next week. Friend, if you are loving what you are learning here on the podcast, you have to come check out my Naturally Thin for Life program. It is my on-demand lifetime access program where I teach you brand new concepts not taught here on the podcast. And I will walk you through exactly how to implement all of the tools I teach you here so that they become just a part of you. You will learn exactly how to understand your specific brain and your specific body so that you become naturally thin for the rest of your life and you no longer struggle with your weight. Inside of the Naturally Thin for Life program, you can also receive live help so that you consistently make progress and reach your goal. I will teach you how to accelerate your naturally thin journey in a sustainable way so that the change becomes permanent. The best part is that it's risk-free. You either love it or I will give you your money back. If you are ready to finally be naturally thin for life, join us at lauradixoncoaching.com/workwithme. That's LauraDixon coaching.com, and click on the Work With Me tab. I cannot wait to see you there.